Good morning. I hope you all had a fantastic first week back at school. It was so lovely to see you all again in person. This morning, I'm going to be talking to you about St. Patrick's Day. St. Patrick's Day is celebrated on March the 17th, and it's packed with parades, good luck charms, and all things green. The event started as a religious holiday, but over time has become a celebration of Irish culture. St. Patrick might be the patron saint of Ireland, but he didn't always live there. Patrick was born in Britain in the 4th century and moved to Ireland when he was 16 years old. After he arrived, Patrick became interested in Christianity and started teaching others about the faith. He is said to have converted many of the country's individuals to Christians, and now St. Patrick's Day is celebrated on the day of his supposed death. St. Patrick was a real person, but some of the traditions associated with him and the holiday are actually myths. For instance, you'll often see the four-leaf clover at St. Patrick's Day. However, according to legend, Patrick actually used a three-leaf clover to represent the Holy Trinity in his teaching. Even though it is possible for a clover to have four leaves, this is normally a good luck charm. Another legend says that Patrick chased all the snakes out of Ireland. The problem with this is that these creatures never actually lived in Ireland. The ocean kept these critters away. Ireland is sometimes referred to as the Emerald Isle due to its luscious green landscape. But the colour originally associated with St. Patrick is blue. Green was introduced to St. Patrick's Day in the 18th century when the shamrock, which is of course green, became a national symbol. Because of the shamrock's popularity and Ireland's landscape, the colour stuck to the holiday. Green is also the colour of the mythical fairy's leprechaun-like dressing. One of today's traditions is that people dress up in green, and this is to avoid getting pinched. The folklore tale goes that leprechauns like to pinch people that they see, and wearing green makes you invisible. There are many traditions around the world. Places like America, St. Patrick's Day is a huge deal, and in Chicago they dye the river green. People also like to gather and watch parades, sing traditional folk songs, and watch traditional dances. However you celebrate, here's hoping it's a lucky day.
Good morning. Poetry. Love it or hate it, there's no denying this oldest of art forms has played an integral part in the way we communicate as a species. However, despite its earliest forms predating even written language, poetry is often accused as being elitist, unrelatable, and shockingly in some cases even boring. So I am here to make the case for poetry, to explain what I think makes poetry great and why it remains something to be celebrated, rather than something to be disregarded and simply discarded to the rubbish bin of history. So what is poetry? Despite the majority of us being familiar with the term due to encountering it either at school or when reading in our own free time, it would appear from asking English students that many of us struggle to actually define what poetry really is. When asked, answers included, it's what old people read. It uses advanced language. It follows a specific set of rules, and it's something which Shakespeare wrote. Now, while all of these are arguably correct to some degree, they don't necessarily answer the question exactly. Unlike prose or unstructured writing, which relies on sentences and paragraphs and is perhaps more representative of spoken language, poetry is generally perceived to be something altogether more artistic in nature. As well as the language used, rhythm, rhyme and the sounds of words are all taken into account when creating a poem. Even the layout of the poem or its structure can be used to convey meaning and effect to the reader, and as such a poem can be viewed as a multidimensional form of communication where every syllable, every piece of punctuation, no matter how seemingly insignificant, has the ability to alter, increase or diminish the ideas of the poet with great effect. But where did poetry come from? The earliest forms of poetry are thought to date back to Africa as early as the 25th century BC. That's 2,500 years before Jesus was born. The earliest poetry is believed to have been recited or sung, employed as a way of remembering oral histories, which would be passed down from generation to generation, with new additions being added or forgotten as the years passed. By the 9th century BC, poetry had become a way of passing on epic tales. The poet Homer's masterpiece, The Odyssey, documented the fabled warrior Odysseus's journey home to Greece following the conclusion of the Trojan War. 500 years later, the art form had clearly continued to grow in popularity, with performances of poems becoming a major form of entertainment within developing societies. So much so that clear genres such as epics, tragedies, and comedies had begun to emerge amongst others. Closer to home, however, it wasn't until the 14th century that poetry became a literary force within England, with Geoffrey Chaucer, the author of the Canterbury Tales, widely being credited as the first writer to demonstrate the English language's poetic capacity. Despite arriving relatively late to the game, the subsequent centuries saw England produce some of the most famous poets the world has ever known, William Shakespeare being just one notable example. And by the 19th century, the emergence of figures such as Keats, Shelley, and Byron, as famous for their hard-drinking and lavish lifestyles as their writing, had secured poets' positions as the rock stars of the age. Over the last 100 years, poets have continued to rise to prominence as audiences have become intrigued with not just poems, but the poets themselves. The blistering condemnation of war, evident in the poem Dulce Decorum Est, would arguably not have had the same impact on audiences had it not been for the personal experiences and tragic death of Wilfred Owen only days before the conclusion of the First World War. Similarly, the significance of Carol Ann Duffy, the first woman, an openly non-heterosexual person, to be appointed as poet laureate, signalling an overdue shift in the values and attitudes of society as a whole. So, to return to my opening argument, it is this, in my opinion, which makes poetry such a vital component to our shared culture, as a society, as a country, and as a species. While seemingly innocuous, poetry has sculpted and continues to sculpt the world around us, possibly in ways we aren't even aware. From its origins in Africa over 4,500 years ago to its continued impact in music, jazz, rap, and pretty much every form of lyrical music you can think of, a world without poetry would be a very, very dull place indeed. So, with World Poetry Day being celebrated on the 21st of March, and in recognition of the important part poetry plays in our lives, I am pleased to announce the creation of a new position of School Poet Laureate at Dover College. The position will be held for 1 year, and it will be the job of our College Poet Laureate to promote poetry here at Dover College, to write original pieces of poetry to celebrate important occasions, and to perform at events throughout the school year. And it is my great pleasure to announce our first ever College Poet Laureate will be none other than Gabriella Hood. For those of you who know Gabby, this probably won't be so much of a surprise. She's a consistently outstanding student, a creative juggernaut, and a passionate advocate of the arts. And we are in absolutely no doubt that Gabby will set an exemplary standard, both now and for all future poet laureates to come. Well done, Gabby. And given this has been an assembly on poetry, it only seems fitting and right to end with a poem. And particularly given the year we've all had, I think something optimistic was appropriate. O sweet tomorrow, after today there will away this sense of sorrow. Then let us borrow hope, for a gleaming soon will be streaming, dimmed by no grey, no grey. While the winds wing us sighs from the gone, nearer to dawn minute beats bring us, when there will sing us larks of a glory, waiting our story further anon, anon. Doff the black token, don the red shoon, write and retune vile strings broken, null the word spoken, in speeches of ruin the night cloud is hewing, tomorrow shines soon, shines soon.
As I am sure you knew, yesterday, The 14th of March was Mother's Day, also known as Mothering Sunday. Mother's Day is now celebrated across the world on various different dates, but in recorded history, the role of the mother has been celebrated and honored since the days of the ancient Greeks. We can use the day not only to honor mothers, but to thank other women who have acted as woman figures in our lives, whether as stepmothers, aunts, big sisters, or grandmothers. Our moms means a lot to us. Do you remember your mom treasuring the pictures you drew or painted as a child? Do you remember your mom teaching you how to tie your shoelaces before you started school? Quite often, a mother will go without so that her children are provided for. This is true selfless love. Of course, there will be times when you disagree or become frustrated by their mothers. But try to see the big picture, that your mother loves you and would probably do anything possible to help you if you were in trouble. If you grew up without a mom, let today be an occasion to honor the mother figure in your life, who have and still do nurture and inspire you. Let's take a minute to think about these important people, the things they do for us, and how we can tell them how much we care. When was the last time you were encouraged by something your parents said or did for you? When was the last time you said thank you to your parents for all they have done and do for you? If and when you are a parent, what kind of mark would you like to leave on the lives of your children? Dear God, thank you for today. I pray that I would glorify you. I pray that my heart would strive to be like you, that my character would reflect you, and that my action represent you in Jesus' name. Amen.